I'm ready this morning. How many of you are ready for the Word of God this morning? Man, there was a while there I was sitting down there thinking, I might have to change this message because God was putting something else on my heart and something that he kind of spoke to me, was speaking to me this week, and it'll probably come out next week. But I wanna let you, before I jump into the text this morning and the Word, I want to let you in on at least this pastor's heart. This pastor's, I don't know what you call it, but how a message actually happens sometimes. How a message actually happens. We had a great service last Sunday, good service. Everything was great. But I got up Monday morning. I got up Monday morning, and I had this burning question in me. You ever have those things where it was just burning in me? And this was the question. Lord, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? And it wasn't just this cat. It was burning inside of me. I couldn't shake it. All day Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, that question, it was just like, and I started studying and listening and in prayer. Lord, what do you want me to do? Now listen, marriage is great. Marriage is great. Kids are doing good. Health is fine. All of that's great. And maybe you're sitting there thinking, oh, it must be the church. We've been at the school 8 months and it hasn't grown the way he thought it would. Well, it's not that either. I'm not giving up, okay? I'm not giving up. Yeah, I did think we'd grow faster, but listen, God told me a long time ago, if I focus in and concern myself with the spiritual growth of the church, he'll build his church. He'll build his church. I do not have to worry about that part of it. And besides all of that, I always think back to this story. How many of you know the story about Abraham bargaining with God? You remember that story? God was coming down and he was literally going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. And Abraham, imagine the audacity to do that, seriously. Abraham starts bargaining with God Almighty. God, if there's 50 people in this city, wouldn't you save it? God's like, yeah, I'd save it for 50. Abraham whittles them all the way down to 10. All the way down to 10. Now, give me a little liberty to say this way this morning. I'm not changing the scripture. But literally, here's what God said. I'm going to word it this way. Literally what God said. I will not give up on Sodom and Gomorrah if there are 10 righteous. I will not give up on Sodom and Gomorrah if there are 10 righteous. Well, let me just tell you this morning. God's not going to give up, and I will not give up on Ignite Church if there is at least 10 righteous. Amen? Now, maybe it's close. I know it's kind of close, but no, I'm kidding you. There's more than 10 righteous here, okay? But so that wasn't, I tell you that because that's not my question. I don't want you to sit there and think, oh, what's he? No, but it was just a burning question to me. Lord, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? And how many of you would agree that's a good question? And I hope you ask that question often of the Lord. I really do. I hope you ask the Lord often, Lord, what do you want me to do? But then by the time Wednesday came around, and I've been listening to some messages, taking notes, writing down my thoughts and praying. But I got to the point on Wednesday, I'm like, okay, and this is my other dilemma. It's like, Lord, are you speaking to me? Is this for me or is this a message? Is this a message? A lot of times, that can be an issue for me because sometimes I feel like sometimes the Lord is like, Troy, I'm speaking to you. I don't want to speak through you this one. This, I'm speaking to you. So I have to decipher sometimes, God, are you speaking? Is this just for me? Or is this something you want to share with your people? So I prayed and continued to pray. And God said, no, I want you to share it, but I want you to share it this way. Because I didn't want to just bring another message on how to know the will of God for your life. How many of you agree that's important? But I mean, we've spoke on that. I mean, you've probably heard hundreds of messages. And I understand the answer to the question, Lord, what do you want me to do? Is going to include the will of God for my life. I do understand that. But I didn't want this just to be, oh, what is the will of God for your life? And then I came across this story. And I want to read you this story this morning. If you've got a Bible, your phone, whatever you might have, turn to John chapter 4. Now I'm going to start you off in the story, and then I'll fill in the story, and then I'll come back to scripture to finish off the story. So if you're there, John chapter 4, verses 1 through 4. And you're going to hear the story, and you're going to probably think, well, what does that have to do with what you're talking about? Just give me some time, okay? John chapter 4, verse 1, it says this. Therefore, when the Lord knew that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself did not baptize, but his disciples. You know, pause there. Isn't that just the way the world is? Always comparing. Oh, look, Jesus has more disciples than John. Oh, no. And it's like Jesus said, I don't care about that. I don't care who has more. We're all working for the same kingdom. Amen. And so Jesus, like, he left Judea and departed again to Galilee. Now, watch this. Underline this if you have a Bible. But he needed, that's a key word right now, but he needed to go through Samaria. So pause right there in your reading, and I'll tell the rest of the story. But that part right there, he needed to go through Samaria. He needed to go through Samaria. That's in there for a reason. And the reason it's in there is because that is not the normal route that Jews would have taken to get to Galilee. They would not have gone through Samaria. The Jews would not have gone through Samaria. Jesus is what? He's Jewish. Most of the 12 disciples were Jewish. Jesus was called to who? To the Jews. They were calling Jesus that he was their Messiah. He was going to take over and rule and reign and overthrow the government in their mindset. Listen, he was not, they didn't go through Samaria. Now, here's the thing I want you to see about Jesus. Yes, Jesus is kind. He's loving. He's compassionate. He's full of mercy. He's full of grace. And please do not take this wrong. I mean this with all respect. But Jesus is and still is today. He is also unpredictable. How many of you would agree with that? Man, he is unpredictable. And when you read through the scriptures, it's like when you think he's going to go right, he goes left. When you think, when they thought, oh, he came, he's the Messiah, he probably came to hang out with the righteous and the religious people. And who'd he hang out with? And he came to, and he hung out with the sinners. When he comes to a blind man who's already having trouble with his eyes, agreed? A blind man is having trouble with their eyes. They can't see. So what does Jesus do? He puts mud in their eyes. That is not even something we would think. He doesn't do it the way you would think. He spit in one guy's eyes. He doesn't do things the way we think. He was going down the road and Zacchaeus was there. Zacchaeus was a tax collector. And he yells to Zacchaeus, hey, tax collector, I'm coming to your house for dinner tonight. He chooses one of his 12 disciples who is a tax collector. He just doesn't do things the way people thought they were going to do it. I remember when I first got saved, this is the last one. I remember when I first got saved, there was this story in the Bible that kind of bugged me. Okay, because Jesus didn't do what I thought he would do. And I didn't understand the culture and the whole story, but it's Jesus's first miracle. Now, I don't know about you. When I first got saved, I heard that Jesus's first miracle was turning water into wine. And I'm thinking, no. No, it would have been the other way around, right? It should have been, God, Jesus, your first miracle should have been turning wine into, like, you know, crystal geyser, spring fresh water. But it wasn't. He was unpredictable in that sense. He didn't always do what they thought he'd do. The most direct route to Galilee was through Samaria. So, but the disciples are like, no, Jesus, no. This way, come this way. We don't go through Samaria, Jesus. The Samaritans are a mixed breed. In their eyes, they were rejected by God. So they're like, no, this way, Jesus. You just don't know your way around. This way. We go this way. But I love Jesus. Jesus is like, follow me, guys. Here we go. Straight through. He goes directly through Samaria, and he sits down at a well. Now, I want you to see this story unfold because it's important to see how unpredictable he is and what Jesus does. So he goes through Samaria. He sits down at a well. Now, watch what happens. A Samaritan is going to appear in our story. And that is already bad, okay? That would, if it was just a Samaritan man walking, the disciples would have already been like, oh. But it gets worse. Sorry, ladies, but this was just the culture in the time. It gets worse. It's not a Samaritan man. It's a Samaritan woman coming to them at this well. It's a Samaritan woman. So the story is getting even worse. It's a Samaritan woman. And the disciples are probably freaking out. They're like, oh, no. Now watch what happens. Jesus has to get them out of the way in order for him to have his way, right? He has to get them out of the way so that he can have his way. So he sends them on an errand. He basically sends them on an errand. Hey, you guys hungry? Yeah. Well, why don't you guys go? I saw a Little Caesars. Okay, Little Caesars would have been back in that time. Okay. I saw a Little Caesars down the road. Why don't you guys go get us some pizza or something, right? So he sends them on an errand just to get them out of the way so that he could have his way. Just so he could have his way. And then Jesus talks to this Samaritan woman. Now, got to give you a little backstory, you guys. This is not just a woman, and it's not just a Samaritan woman. This is more of a, sorry, but this is the best way I could figure to say it. This is more of a desperate housewife of Samaria, okay? That's who this lady is. She is like a desperate housewife of Samaria. She has a past. And just the fact that she is there at 12 o'clock noon, the scriptures tell us specifically that they came to the well at noon. Nobody's at the well at noon. Everybody came in the morning when it was cool with their water pots and everything. This lady could not come in the morning because she was so full of guilt and shame, and she would be ridiculed. So she comes at noon. She comes at noon. Here's what you need to see in this story. Jesus goes in a direction that they thought that he shouldn't, just to talk to one woman. Just to talk to one woman with a past, full of guilt, full of shame. So he engages her, and I'm just going to tell you the story. He engages her in a conversation. And when Jesus speaks to her, watch this, she is shocked. She is shocked. He speaks to the Samaritan woman, and the woman herself is shocked. Now, let me just tell you the story. This woman has already had 5 failed marriages, and she's shacking up with the guy even now. So I'm telling you that because I just think she had attitude, okay? I just think she probably had attitude, and she's coming to the well, and this Jewish guy starts talking to her. And I think she's probably just like, I don't impersonate a woman very well, but I think she's just kind of like, you talking to me? I need Pastor Toyin up here, huh? You talking to me? I think she's looking at Jesus like, honey, you talking to me? And she's probably looking at him like, can't you tell? Can't you tell I'm not one of you? Can't you tell I'm not one of you? Can't you? Come on, dude. Can't you tell I'm a woman? I'm a woman. Don't you be posting those, okay? Can't you tell I'm a woman? Can't you tell I'm not one of you? I think she had attitude up there. And so Jesus starts just engaging her in a conversation. Now the conversation itself goes to worship. The conversation with the Samaritan woman goes to worship. But here's what's going on. You need to understand the backstory, what's going on. Basically, she's just trying to keep the conversation off of her issues. She's not that worried about worship, where we're supposed to worship and all of that. Basically, she is just trying to keep the conversation off of her issues. Now, come on. You don't have to raise your hand. You can sit on your hands if you want. You ever done that? Come on. You ever done that? Man, you've got financial issues. You've got moral issues. Some of you got anger issues out there. You've got marriage issues. You got family issues. And you're like, yeah, I got all those issues. But you know what? I'd really rather talk about this one scripture in Revelation, okay? That's the way we are, because it's not personal. It's not personal. It's kind of like, hey, how you doing? Well, to be honest with you, I'd rather talk about this scripture in Isaiah 13. Because listen, here's what we should probably talk about is your marriage. What we should probably talk about is your temper. What we should probably talk about is your addiction. What we should probably talk about is what you might be checking out on your computer at night. What we should probably be talking about are the issues that you have, but we don't. Instead, it's like, no, I'd rather talk about Isaiah chapter 13. Yeah, like that makes sense, huh? Like, that makes sense. But that's what's going on in this story. And I believe that's what a lot of us do. She's kind of in one of those moments. I don't want to talk about my 5 failed marriages or my live-in friend that I'm shacking up with right now. What I'd like to talk about is where we're supposed to worship. But here's what I love about Jesus. Here's what I love about Jesus. If you know him, you know this is just the way he operates. Jesus isn't like, nope, I know what you're up to. He knew about the 5 marriages, and you'll see that in a moment. But Jesus isn't like, I know what you're up to, woman. Jesus is like, okay. I just picture him this way. Okay? It's like, okay, then we'll talk about worship. You want to talk about worship? We'll talk about worship. Now, you can read the story later, but Jesus literally breaks it down for her. He breaks it down for her. And when Jesus is done, she is like, whoa, I've never heard anything like that. I've never heard it explained that way. It's good reading. You should go back and read it. But she is just like, wow, he broke it down. But then the woman gets to that point where she's like, well, I don't really know about all of that. I just know this. Someday the Messiah is coming and he's going to fix all of this, all of that. And you know what Jesus does? You know what she says? I just know this. I know that one day Messiah is coming. You know what Jesus does? I'm just going to put it in modern day language. Jesus just goes like this. Ta-da! Like, I'm here. Hello? It's me. The one you were talking about, that Messiah that you were talking about who's coming to fix all of this, that's me. He literally tells her that, basically. He didn't say ta-da, but he says, yeah, I'm him. I'm him. I'm that one. And then he probably saw the doubt or whatever. So he says, in fact, I'll prove to you that I'm that Messiah. I'll prove to you that I am that Messiah. Without her telling him, without him supposedly knowing it, Jesus says to her, you've had 5 husbands, which I'm sure she went, oh, he knew. And then he breaks it down. He says, and in fact, the one you're living with now is not even your husband. And you can read it, but I love her response. I love her response. She's like, I perceive that you are a prophet. that's one of those duh moments, right? I perceive you are a prophet. And again, I love Jesus. It's not like this big old correction. I think Jesus is like, well, it's a little bit more than that. Remember that ta-da moment a moment ago? Remember that? Yeah, it's a little more than a prophet. He's like, I'm that Messiah. I am he. I am he that you're speaking of. And then about that time, the story goes on. And about that time, and I'm going to put it this way so that everybody understands this. About that time, his 12 prejudiced disciples come around the corner. Okay, because we look in our society like prejudice is something new. It's in the Bible. His 12 prejudiced disciples round the corner. And I'm just betting on this, but I'm betting they round the corner and see Jesus talking to a Samaritan woman. And I bet Jesus and the woman could hear them breathe. I bet it was like round the corner. I bet they could hear them from a mile away. I bet they could hear them. And they round that corner and they're like, what? Oh, no. And so at about this time, I believe the Samaritan woman, she sees them and she probably realizes, I think it's time for me to go. But I think she also realizes this Jesus, he's not like those other 12. There's something about this Jesus. In fact, he's like nobody I've ever met. And the rest of the story goes on. She goes back to the town. She tells everybody in the town about Jesus and how this could be the Messiah. And the whole town comes out. There's healings. There's salvation. Listen, a revival breaks out where? In Samaria. A revival breaks out in the place that the Jews aren't supposed to go, in this place that God is supposed to hate these half-breed people. A revival breaks out there. Okay, back to our story. That's all really good reading. You should read it. But back to the well. These guys round the corner. Now, if you read the story, they all wanted to ask. They all wanted to ask, what in the why were you talking? What were you thinking, Jesus? They all wanted to ask him what he was thinking and why he was talking to him. Now, here's the problem, though. Jesus already knew what they were thinking. Even though they were afraid to ask and they all wanted to ask, they didn't ask, but Jesus already knew. He knew exactly what they were thinking. And then one of them, or I don't know, a couple of them, however many of them, one of them says, okay, one of the disciples, you must be hungry. You must be hungry. Jump down to our story, John chapter 4, verse 31 now. So in the meantime, his disciples urged him, saying, Rabbi, or teacher, eat. You must be hungry. Eat. Now watch this. But Jesus said to them, I have food to eat of which you do not know. Therefore, the disciples said to one another, has anyone brought him anything to eat? I love, you got to see the story unfold. I love the Bible. I love the Word of God. I love the stories in here because sometimes we just don't see things the way they really happen. Jesus says, I've got food to eat that you don't even know about. And I love these guys. We look at them sometimes as St. Peter and St. John. Can I tell you something this morning? And we learned it and you heard it in prayer time. It wasn't St. Peter. It wasn't St. John. It was St. Normal. And it was Saint Average. These were just normal, average men. And even when Jesus said that, they're just like, did you get him food? They're like bewildered. They don't get the spiritual implication of what Jesus was saying. They're bewildered. They're looking at each other like, did you go buy him food? I didn't get him food. I bet one of them looked at Judas. How many of you know who Judas was? They probably looked at Judas. I saw you dip in and grab a little extra money. Did you go buy him food? And Jesus is like, Judas is like, no, I didn't buy any food. You know what he did with the money, okay? That's just my intake on that one, okay? But they're like, who got him some food? Did you get him some food? Now we'll read on verse 34. And Jesus said to them, here's the text I want you to get this morning. My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Let me read that again. Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Watch this. Jesus talks about food. Catch this. Jesus talks about food as God's will. Jesus is basically saying, when you do God's will, it's like food. It's like food. And now I'm processing all of this story and that question that has been burning inside of me. Lord, what do you want me to do, Lord? What do you want me to do, Lord? And I want to help you understand like that question that was ringing in me with another story, okay? Now, this one's not in the Bible. How many married men, women, okay? Quite a few of you. Maybe you will understand this story, okay? You ever ask that question to your wife? Honey, what do you want me to do? Honey, what do you... Now listen, if you're first married, when I was first married, I didn't think I needed to ask that question. I thought I was in charge, okay? I've been married long enough to know that that's just not true, okay? But have you ever asked that question? Honey, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? I'm going to share a story with you. I hope I don't get in trouble with this one, but I don't think I will. We've been married 37 years. Okay, now I'm going to tell you something about me, and this is just the way it is. I am terrible at gift giving. My wife, see, I already got an amen, okay? I am terrible at gift giving, not at giving gifts. I could repent. I've probably gotten it right. I've given more than three gifts in the 37 years, okay? But I've probably only gotten it right about three times. Come on, three at least. I heard once up there, okay? At least I can think of about three gifts that I probably got right, nailed it. And she's like, wow. The others, it's like, I don't throw away receipts. It's like, they get returned. They get returned. And I've learned, I'm good with that. It's okay. I'm a completely different person in the sense that she can buy me something. She could buy me a shirt. And I'll open it up and I'll look at it. Now, my mind thought is, doesn't say Nike, it doesn't say Adidas or Under Armour or anything, so I don't know. But it's like if I'm wearing a shirt like this one probably that doesn't have a Nike emblem on it, my wife probably bought it for me. But I don't take it back because I'm thinking, even when, have you ever opened a box? And I'm just, we were talking, Mauricio and I am so out of fashion and I don't even care, okay, most of the time. But I will open a box or she'll buy me a shirt. And honestly, I'm looking at it in my mind and thank God she's not Jesus and knows what I'm thinking. In my mind, I'm thinking, are you kidding? You didn't buy that, right? You got it off some homeless guy, right? Or something. I'm just thinking, you want me to wear that? But in the back of my mind, I'm also thinking, okay, it probably will look good. And I just don't know it, okay? If I'm wearing dress shoes, I didn't pick them out. Again, if they're not tennis shoes, I didn't pick them out. So when she buys me a gift, it's completely opposite. I just roll with it. But when I buy a gift, man, I'm never even close. So it's about 10 or 15 years ago. It's our anniversary. Husbands, listen, don't side with me this morning. Okay, husbands, do not get yourself in trouble. In fact, if any time during this story you just want to lean over to your wife and say, man, I'd never do that, honey. Feel free to do it, okay? You don't have to back me up. I don't even care. I don't want you to get in trouble. I don't want you to go down with me. This was like 10 or 15 years ago. I'm coming home from work. It's our anniversary. And I, you already know where the story's going, I am going to get her flowers. Like any good husband would do, right? I'm going to get her flowers. And then I see these beautiful flowers in a vase. Oh, they were beautiful. How many of you have ever seen silk flowers? Practical! So all the women are already like, nah, they're shaking. They know where the women know where this story is going. The men are probably still thinking, yeah, so what's the problem? No, these flowers were beautiful. And listen, they would last years. They're a gift that keeps on giving, okay? They're a gift that keeps on giving. So I'm thinking, I'm bringing home these beautiful flowers to my honey, and I'm going to be like the hero. Yeah, some of you already know where the story's going. I can tell, but I was not the hero, okay? And these flowers did not last that long either. They lasted about a day, maybe two. I don't even know if they lasted that long, okay? But, huh? Okay, they didn't even last 2 hours, okay? They didn't even last 2 hours, okay? But all is well. We have 9 kids, so things went well still after that, okay? So not to get into details there. All right, so I could have had 20. Let's keep going before I get in trouble, okay? I'm already in trouble, you're right. I shouldn't even brought that back to her memory, okay? But at some point during that whole ordeal, I'm like, honey, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? Now, ladies, you can help me out with this, finish this sentence. I shouldn't have to tell you. Come on, women, yeah? I shouldn't, ladies, can I just help you out this morning? You need to tell us what to do, okay? you can pay me later. You need to tell us what to do. And if you happen to be married to a man who is great at giving gifts and knows exactly what to do, man, you better love him with all your heart. We hate him, but you better love him, okay? Ladies, you need to tell us what to do, okay? You need to tell us what to do. So I tell you that story because many of us, follow me back to reality here. That was reality, but back to the story. Many of us, our relationship with God is similar. We're constantly saying, God, just tell me what you want me to do. Just tell me what you want me to do. Listen, we believe that God is all powerful. We believe that God has a purpose and a plan for our lives individually and corporately, that he cares enough. But sometimes it's just like, Lord, please, Lord, just tell me what you want me to do. Now, listen to me. In some ways, he's telling you. I think sometimes the Lord could answer back and said, I've told you, and I don't want to get too far into all of this. It could be another teaching for another time, but most of you already know this. Your desires, your passions, your abilities, he's wired you individually for exactly what he wants you to do. Each one of you. I don't want to get sidetracked there, but that's why we're all made different. That's why we're all created different. We all like different things. We all do things different ways. We're all called to reach people, but we're wired differently to reach different people. Amen? That's what this is all about. God's goal is for us to reach people, but people are different. All of us are wired differently to reach different people. I don't want to get down the road, so I got to go back to our story. They come back and they're like, Jesus, you need to eat. And he's like, I have food to eat that you don't even know about. I looked it up in a commentary. It's the one commentary that I liked basically said, Jesus was speaking Hebrew street language, basically. Because what Jesus said to them was basically something like this. If we could break it down in today's language, Jesus was telling them, I've got good eating. I've got good eating. Man, I've got some good eats. I've got some good eats. That's what he was saying. And he's telling them, guys, listen to me. You don't understand. Something happens to my entire being when I do what the Father has created me to do. That's what he's telling them. Something happens to my entire being when I'm doing what the Father sent me to do. He's like, man, I feel nourished. I feel strengthened. I feel energized. I may have walked up to this well tired and exhausted, but then I did the will of my Father, and now I'm like nourished again. I'm strengthened. I'm encouraged. I'm ready to go. I'm ready to go. That, listen, that full feeling you have when you eat a good meal, that's the same feeling we should have when we do what God has created us to do. It should be one of those, how many have ever had those, right? Not when you've eaten too much, but when you've eaten and it's just like, That's what it should feel like when you're doing what our Heavenly Father has created you to do. Now, follow me on all of this, because I'm walking a rope here. I don't want to make too big of a deal of this in the sense of God's will, in the sense that we begin. See, what happens is when people start telling you, well, you want to fulfill God's will for your life, we start thinking, that means I'm going to speak at Staples Center. That means I'm going to raise the dead. That means I'm going to heal cancer. All of those things can happen. All of those things can happen, okay? But I think sometimes when we talk about the will of God for our lives, we begin to think way out there. And it's not, God, listen to me. God doesn't rank us, if that makes any sense. We look at people and we rank people. We rank people by how much money they make, right? By how much influence they have, by their education, how much degree. We rank people, we put them in categories according to their position. God doesn't do that. God doesn't do that with us. To God, watch this, to God, success is doing what he's called you to do. Big or small, it doesn't matter. Big or small, success to God is you doing what he's called you to do. That's it. That's it. That's success to God. And maybe you're here this morning, but you're here today and you're like, Lord, what do you want me to do? I don't know if you've ever asked that question, and I think it's a good question to ask. But if you're asking it this morning, Lord, what do you want me to do? It's in Ecclesiastes. It's in 1 Samuel. I'm going to give you the verse in 1 Samuel, but it's in there a couple of times. And usually when something's in the Word of God a couple of times, it's because God wants us to get it. Amen. So here's the 1 Samuel reading of 1 Samuel chapter 10, verse 7b. It says this. Do whatever your hand finds to do, for God is with you. Lord, what do you want me to do? Whatever your hand finds to do. Whatever your hand finds to do. Now, obviously, that's got to be morally correct. It's got to be legal. You can't be like, oh, look, 2 pounds of cocaine just dropped into my hands, and this drug dealer wants to buy them. I can make thousands of dollars, okay? No, listen, whatever comes into your hands, God will divinely place people, situations into your hands. What do you want me to do, Lord? Do whatever your hand finds to do, for God is with you. For God is with you. Listen. I'm struggling, but I'll get it all out. I promise you. Don't think. I got so many notes here. Don't think right now I'm doing this. Right now I'm doing this, whatever it might be in your life. Right now I'm doing this so that eventually I can get to this. See, don't think that way. And let me just, I'm not going to say I'm 100% correct in this, but I don't really even believe that's a teaching in the Bible. I don't really believe that's what the Bible teaches. And you might be thinking, well, Troy, what about David fighting Goliath? David fought Goliath, and it says, and it talks about because he killed the lion and the bear, he was able to kill Goliath, right? You know that story? And I get that, but think about it this way. When David killed the lion, listen, it was all about the lion. It was all about the lion. He wasn't thinking, hey, I'm going to kill this lion and then someday I'm going to kill a giant. Listen, his mind, his eyes, what he was doing, he was focused on the lion and nothing else. When he killed the bear, it was all about the bear. Yeah, it gave him the strength and everything to defeat Goliath and all of that. But at that moment in time, it was all about the lion. And it was all about the bear. Listen, you need to get this morning, because it's about who you are and where you are right now. Right now. Who you are and where you are right now. Listen, you're very seldom is your job, follow me on this, because some of this might surprise you, but very seldom is your job about your job. It's about who he's called you to at your job, in that place. It's who you are and who you are affecting. I breezed through this part, but most of you, some of you know me. I worked in a grocery warehouse for 30 years. It's a long time. It wasn't until the last 20 years that I saw that warehouse as my mission field. There was over 1,000 guys in that warehouse. And for a lot of that time, I was bivocational. I was working in the warehouse 40 plus hours and pastoring a church. And I didn't recognize that workplace was a mission field. The first 10 years I worked there. The last 20, can I just tell you something? I love pastoring. I love doing that. I was ministering to 1,000 people in a warehouse. I don't know what our church got up to in Riverside, 200, whatever, and 200 in a church. But there was 1,000 guys in that warehouse. And the minute I saw it as a mission field. You see, I could tell you this morning, God got me the job there. Just the circumstances and the way things happened, it was all God. But I thought God put me there to make money. I'll be honest. I thought God's putting me there to make money, made good money. I killed it on their incentive program, made even more money, had medical benefits that I could have 9 kids and didn't have to pay. The medical benefits covered all of that. I'm like, God, you put me here to help me make money and have kids and do all of that, all of that. I didn't realize until after the first 10 years. No, he didn't put me there to make money. He put me there to make a difference. And I want to encourage you and tell you that wherever you're at, school, your workplace, you own a business, you run a business, your position at your work, you're there to make a difference. And here's what I noticed as I was thinking about that this week. The last 20 years, I remember this, I didn't mind going to work. I mean, most of you, sometimes you get up in the morning and you're like, I want to go to work. I didn't have that mindset the last 20 years. I'm not saying I wouldn't rather stay at home or go to the beach or anything like that, but I didn't mind going to work. And I didn't realize it then, but I'm realizing it now this week as I was thinking about it. It was exactly what Jesus was talking about in this story. It was literally food to my soul. I was full. I was satisfied. I was nourished. I was doing the work that God had prepared me for. And it was great. Now, some of you are thinking, that's it, Troy. That's it. I just need to change jobs. I just need to change jobs. Listen, I didn't change jobs after the first 10 years. I changed Troy. And when Troy changed his mindset, my job began to change. My attitude began to change. And once I did that, the job itself became food. And I'm going to put it this way. It became good eats. Now watch this. Back to our story. Jesus looks at these 12 young men and he says, when I do the will of God, he says, it's like food. It's like food. And I told you, these guys are just normal men. I think they're scratching their head. They're not getting, and they're like, if they could have asked, and if they did, they're like, the will of God? The will of God is for you to be talking to this desperate housewife of Samaria? They're like, seriously? Is that what you're telling us? If Jesus had said that doing the will of God was food while he was teaching in the synagogue, if he did that, if he was teaching in the synagogue and he said, man, this is like food, they would have said, okay, I get that. I get that. But he didn't. He says it while he's at a well that a Jewish man shouldn't be at, while he's talking to a woman who's had 5 husbands and is shacking up with someone now, and a woman full of guilt and shame. He restores her. He invites her into his kingdom. And then he returns to his 12 and says, I just did the will of God. I just did the will of God. The will of God is God's plan for your part in his story. That's all it is. It's God's plan for your part in his story. I'm going to start wrapping it up, I promise. If tomorrow's just another Monday for you, Come on, I've been there. How many of you hated Mondays? Man, if tomorrow's just another Monday, another day to get through, and you're living for the weekend, you're living for Friday, listen to me carefully this morning. That's the farthest thing from God's plan for your life. It really is. God doesn't want us living for the weekend. He wants us living for every single day that he's given us on this earth. And I've got a hunch that some of you are probably thinking this morning, I don't know what God wants me to do. Yeah, Troy, that is my question. God, Lord, what do you want me to do? You're probably sitting there this morning, most of you, asking that question, Lord, what do you want me to do? Can I tell you something this morning? Join the party. I don't always know. And listen, as a pastor, I get asked this question all the time. Pastor Troy, what is your vision for the church? And I get that. The Bible says that without a vision, the people perish. I get all of that. But sometimes I get so tired of that question. I feel like a Coke machine, like a vision dispenser. You know, put a dollar in and I'll spit out a vision for you, right? Or we'll put it on a nice tagline under the name of our church. Or 2018, here's our new. Sometimes I feel that way, okay? But I understand the scripture. I understand the scriptures. And I will say this morning, because I will tell you what I believe that God is showing me and leading me. And God has intentions to do something here through each and every one of you, me, us, and Ignite Church. I can tell you that without reservation. God has some intentions to do something great here. And I'm going to say this. I feel like prophesying over you. Listen, the seasons are about to change for some of you this morning. Some of you, your seasons are about to change in this sense. I believe that God wants to expand some of your borders. I believe that for some of you this morning, God is changing your season and he's going to begin to expand some of your borders. And by expanding some of your borders, some of that's going to be in your financial area. God's going to expand the borders that your finances have kept you tied into. I believe that for some of you this morning, God is going to expand your borders in relationships. Maybe you're looking for him. Maybe you're in relationships. But God's going to begin to expand those borders. He's going to begin to expand those borders financially, in position at work, all your business, all of those things. But listen to me in this. In these days that we live in, listen, because this goes right along with what I just said. In these days that we live in, God is going to ask more of you and I. You're probably sitting there right now this morning. I take that word. I claim that word. And then when I say God is going to ask more of you and I don't want that word. I don't want that word. I'll take the first one, but I don't want that one. Listen, in this day and age that we live in, God is going to ask more of you and I. Not to my vision. You see, God has a vision, and his vision has a church, and his vision has people. And that's the vision God is calling you into. And when we grab a hold of that, man, we're going to see things begin to unlock for us. Lord, what do you want me to do? Here's the first, this isn't a point, this is my first close, okay? Lord, what do you want me to do? Here's the first thing. Be who he wants you to be. Just be who he wants you to be. Watch me on this. Not what he wants you to be. Be who he wants you to be. You see, sometimes we get so focused on what I'm supposed to do for a living, what my vocation is, that's all of a sudden we have this mindset that what I do for a living is going to dictate who I am. God is concerned about what you do for a vocation and what you do for a living. But listen, God is more concerned with who you are rather than what you are. Who you are is what comes first. Now, what happens to us is we get so focused on the what. All of us do. And it takes away from the who. Listen, I'm going to be brutally honest because this is my life. This is probably yours. And here's sometimes what we literally say, what we literally pray. Lord, bless this relationship that I'm in. Even though it's taking up all my time. Even though it's coming before you. God, bless this relationship. How many think you will? Listen, I know this because I can tell you with absolute certainty, he gave me that job. He's taking care of me. But there's times in my life where I could say, Lord, bless me. Help me to make more money on incentive. Lord, bless my business. Bless my work. Lord, bless me. Give me this promotion, even though it's already consuming all my time and taking away from my time with my family.
even though my job is already consuming all my time and I don't pray like I used to. I don't read or study God's word like I used to. I don't come to church like I used to. But God, would you bless my business and give me even more business? I mean, you know, probably not going to happen. God, would you bless my finances even though I'm not putting you first? But then we sit back and we say, Lord, what do you want me to do? He wants you to focus in on the who first. Who he's created you to be. If we will do that, if you will do that, if you will focus in on who he's created you to be, then he wants you to realize the what we do for the who he's sending us to. Can I say that again in case I lost you? He wants us to focus on the what we do for the who that he's sending us to. Listen, do whatever he has for you to do. Last scripture, Ephesians 2:10. For we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works. Watch this. Which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. He's already prepared works, things for you to do. And he wants you. He won't make you. He wants you to walk in them. And the minute you figure out who you are, the minute you trust God for who you are, the what will come right alongside of it. And the who you're supposed to affect and reach will come right alongside of that. And listen, here's my last, I promise, this is it. And then it'll be food to your soul. It'll be food to your soul. And you'll be like, ah, oh, I feel so good inside in my spirit. You'll be feeding your spirit, man. That's what Jesus was telling the 12. I have food to eat that you don't even know about. I have good eats that you don't even know about. Well, we don't have to be like the 12 and not know what he was talking about. This morning, you can know exactly what he's talking about. He's telling you, he's telling me, man, when you do what I've created you to do, when you do what I've purposed you to do, it's going to be like good eats to your soul. And you're going to be so nourished, so fulfilled, so energized. I want to pray for you this morning.